Earlier this spring, I collected soil samples from 7 of the growing spaces we manage and sent them off to a lab for detailed analysis, which is something I've done periodically over the past 12 years. The test results came back with a lot of interesting details about the availability of a wide range of major and minor plant nutrients. In addition, the tests also indicated the percent organic matter found within each soil sample, which is a key indicator of how successful the different management practices in the gardens have been. Over the years, the amount of organic matter in some of the gardens has gradually increased, stayed relatively the same or even decreased in other gardens, and even changed quite dramatically in one of them. Where the organic matter has increased in the soil, this indicates that additional carbon dioxide has been drawn out of the atmosphere, where it is increasingly causing problems, and sequestered as the main component of the organic matter that is helping to build soil in the process. But this sequestration involves more than just carbon, and I'm beginning to see how this might be limiting the soil development in some of the gardens. Based on these soil test results, the percentage of organic matter in the 7 gardens currently ranges from just under 9% to over 20%. However, I suspect that 20% is not really representative of the actual soil in that garden. I think that the soil sample that I took may have included too much of the desiccated compost on the surface of the beds in this protected growing space, leading to a result that is way higher than anything I'd seen in any of the other gardens. Excluding that potential outlier result, the no-dig garden had the highest amount of organic matter at almost 16%. The soil within the smaller polytunnel contains about 13.5% organic matter, and 12.5% was found in the polyculture garden, and both of these seem reasonable. An unexpected result is that the soil in the intensive garden only has about 11% organic matter, especially compared to the almost 10% in the extensive garden, despite significant differences in the amount of compost added each year to these gardens. The soil in the simple garden seems to be degrading, as it only has about 8.5% organic matter, which is one of the lowest results I have ever seen for these gardens. The soil in this garden is definitely lighter in color than the soil in some of the other gardens. Comparing the dried soil samples side by side, the difference is obvious, with the soil becoming much darker as proportions of soil organic matter increases. I began testing the soil of some of these gardens over a decade ago, with the other gardens being established since then. And it is interesting to observe how the amount of organic matter in the soil has changed over time, or not. Back in 2012, the 5 gardens that I tested all had below 10% organic matter, and since then the levels of organic matter in the extensive garden have remained relatively consistent, ranging from 9 to 11%. In this garden we feed the plants with concentrated fertility and seem to be adding just enough compost to maintain the soil quality. The levels of organic matter in the soils of the intensive garden have only slightly increased, despite adding at least 25 millimeters of compost each year onto the surface of the beds. In contrast, the amount of organic matter in the no-dig garden has increased dramatically to about 16% after I started using the douting method of adding substantial layers of compost each year. The levels in the polyculture garden have gradually increased with a steady application of compost and biochar, both of which I think are included in the percent organic matter, but biochar doesn't decompose. Unfortunately, the soil in the simple garden appears to be degrading, at least based on the 2 tests I've done, but I only tested the soil in the 1 bed that had been covered with a huge amount of organic matter 2 years earlier. In the older and smaller polytunnel garden, the amount of organic matter in the soil has been gradually increasing at a fairly steady rate. Ignoring the unusually high results this year from the larger polytunnel of the black plot, it's interesting to note that this soil initially had low levels of organic matter in the beginning of 2018, before I grew a big green manure crop, which was mulched on the surface of the bed for the 2019 season underneath a crop of tomatoes and peppers. However, the next year, in the spring of 2020, the organic matter had dropped further to 7.5%, raising questions about the extent to which green manures can actually build soil, at least based on these very limited results. There are potential issues with this type of soil testing, which can produce misleading results, as I think happened with the larger polytunnel. I was also unsure how much of the layers of compost to scrape aside when collecting the soil sample from the no-dig garden, but as the plant roots seem to be able to colonize a lot of the compost, it is probably better to include most of the layer. In the other smaller polytunnel, the results have been showing a gradual increase in the amount of soil organic matter over 12 years, which I think I can trust. The test results went from about 9.8% to 13.4% organic matter, which is an increase in 3.6 percentage points over a 12-year period, or it takes about 3 years to increase by 1%. But this means that there is about 36% more organic matter in the soil compared to the initial baseline when I started growing in this garden. And the total exchange capacity, which is a measure of the amount of nutrients that the soil can hold, has increased from 12 to over 17 in the same time period, and is likely due to the increase in the soil organic matter. This is essentially a process of soil building that should result in the soil being able to support more crops. All of this organic matter is carbon-based, including the soil organisms, the decaying parts of plants, and the residues from the compost and mulches that I add to the gardens. By making some basic assumptions and using typical figures, I can calculate how much carbon there is in this topsoil. These soil tests are conducted on the top 15 centimeters of soil, which weighs about 220 kilograms per square meter, or approximately 22 tons for the entire 100 square meter polytunnel. So the total weight of organic matter has increased by almost 800 kilograms over the 12 years, averaging about 66 kilograms per year. Soil organic matter apparently contains about 58% elemental carbon, so this means that there has been an increase of almost 460 kilograms of carbon, or just under 40 kilograms of carbon sequestered each year. These figures are approximate, of course, and only account for the top layer of soil, but that's where most of the organic matter is found. The amount of organic matter in the full depth of soil would be slightly larger. 460 kilograms of carbon translates to 1.7 tons of carbon dioxide being pulled out of the air by plants and sequestered or temporarily stored in the soil in this one garden, or about 140 kilograms of CO2 each year. Doing similar calculations for the other gardens, some are losing carbon and others are gaining carbon. But, excluding the possible faulty data from the other polytunnel, in total the six gardens are apparently pulling an average of almost 500 kilograms of CO2 out of the atmosphere each year and storing it in the topsoil, which doesn't seem like a lot. Or, in reality, we are adding a huge amount of compost and mulch to these six gardens each year, and a portion of the carbon that is in the compost has remained in the topsoil, in addition to some of the carbon in the remains of the vegetable plants and green manures that we grow. If management practices change, or I decide to use less compost each year, the amount of soil organic matter may actually decrease, releasing some of the carbon back into the atmosphere again as CO2. I doubt that this rate of increase of soil organic matter and carbon sequestration can continue indefinitely, and it also requires substantial amounts of resources, and apparently requires the availability of other key nutrients. From what I understand, in order for carbon to remain in very stable forms in the soil, where it can provide all those great benefits to the soil structure, soil life, and plant growth, the carbon needs to be combined with nitrogen, phosphorus, and sulfur in fairly consistent ratios. Apparently, these three nutrients act as stabilizing elements for the more stable forms of carbon in the soil. And if these three elements aren't available in the right proportions, then the carbon won't stay in the soil. I think this is really interesting, and this could be a key factor in why some gardens see an increase in soil organic matter while others don't. That it is not just about the amount of carbon that is added, or if the soil is tilled or not. According to this research, every kilogram of carbon in these stable forms in the soil requires about 80 grams of nitrogen, 20 grams of phosphorus, and 14 grams of sulfur. If I assume that the yearly increase in organic matter in the polytunnel is in this stable form of carbon, and I'm not entirely sure that it is, then the 40 kilograms of carbon sequestered each year would require 3.2 kilograms of nitrogen, 700 grams of phosphorus, and 560 grams of sulfur. That is a lot more than I thought it would be, especially if it happens every year, and this amount needs to be in addition to the amounts of these key nutrients needed by the plants and the soil biology. There may be other factors that I don't understand, but this seems to be a significant cost in building soil and sequestering carbon that I had not really considered before. I think this is quite a different way of looking at the processes of building soil in the gardens. It's not just about the carbon, the compost, cover crops, and the diversity of soil organisms, but also having enough spare nitrogen, phosphorus, and sulfur to be sequestered with that carbon. Nitrogen is, of course, one of the key nutrients in a vegetable garden, and some of the vegetable plants I grew used to struggle because of a lack of nitrogen, until I started using better quality compost and concentrated forms of nitrogen to supplement the lower quality compost we were importing. The tests that I did 12 years ago revealed lower levels of phosphorus in the soil than when I started the gardens, but these levels have gradually increased over the years, though not as much in the simple garden. The tests also reveal a low baseline of available sulfur, which is apparently easily locked up in the abundant calcium in the calcareous soils that we have. Despite the addition of compost, general amendments, and occasionally concentrated sulfur to the various outside gardens, the level of available sulfur has not changed significantly over the past decade. The simple garden's available sulfur are particularly low, well below the desired levels. I suspect that it is this lack of sulfur, possibly in combination with lower levels of phosphorus, that is preventing the more stable forms of carbon from being established in this garden. If the soil biology and plant roots find it easier to obtain the sulfur that they need from within the stable organic matter, rather than trying to extract the sulfur that is locked up in the calcareous soils, then I can see how the organic matter levels in this garden could be declining, or at least not increasing. The lack of soil building in this garden could partially be because of a lack of sulfur, not necessarily because of a lack of carbon. Continuing to increase the organic matter content in the soil of all the gardens would be beneficial. More organic matter in various forms would provide more food for soil organisms and improve the soil's ability to hold water and nutrients, all of which can be beneficial for the plants. And building up more soil organic matter, particularly in the more stable forms, means that we're drawing more carbon dioxide out of the atmosphere and sequestering it as carbon in the soils. But if specific proportions of nitrogen, phosphorus, and sulfur are needed to retain carbon in these valuable stable forms, the nutrient with the lowest availability could be the limiting factor. In some gardens or ecosystems where nitrogen, phosphorus, and sulfur are all available in sufficient amounts, it might be the amount of carbon that is a limiting factor. In other soils, it might be limited amounts of nitrogen or phosphorus that might be causing issues. But in all the gardens that we manage, it seems that not enough available sulfur could be limiting the buildup of soil organic matter, especially in the simple garden. If this is what has been happening, and if we can easily correct this by regularly adding gypsum or some other form of sulfur, then we might be able to improve the soil some more, so that it can better support the plants we grow, and we can harvest even more food. It would also make better use of the carbon-rich biomass that we collect from the surrounding landscape for use in this simple garden, and make better use of all of the compost that we make and import for use in the other gardens. To keep hold of as much of this carbon as possible to help develop the soil for future seasons, while also feeding the plants this year in order to feed ourselves.